When Tyrese Haliburton went number 12 in the most recent NBA draft to the Sacramento Kings, there were quite a few eyebrows raised. Firstly, how did he slip all the way to 12 as someone who looked to be at the very least a top 10 prospect, potentially a top 5 in some people's estimations? And why would the Sacramento Kings draft a guard when they already had Buddy Hield, Bogdan Bogdanovic, and De'Aaron Fox on that roster? Well, not too long after, we found out Bogdan was out the door, and there was some expectation that Buddy might follow suit as well, but that's yet to happen and doesn't look like happening at the moment. But more importantly, it doesn't seem to be a need at this point just because of the versatility of Haliburton on both ends of the floor, which we're going to talk about in a bit. But before I even do that, if you could subscribe to the channel and drop a like, I make content like this pretty much every day and doing so really helps out a lot. That's pretty much all I need you to do, so that would be appreciated anyways. Now, I don't claim to be a draft expert, but one of the few prospects that I had a vested interest in this year was Tyrese Haliburton. And Haliburton just stood out to me. His poise, his length, his defensive upside, and numbers all seemed phenomenal. And the more I continued to watch, the more I liked. An immediate similarity I saw in his game was someone like Shai Gilgeous-Alexander. Not a direct like-for-like, because you never really see that, but it was more so Halliburton's ability to accelerate and decelerate, which I think is one of the most important attributes to have in basketball. Someone like Luka Doncic is an expert at it, and it allows players who aren't exceptional athletes to get separations without being as quick as De'Aaron Fox or John Wall, and that's a trait I really liked about Tyrese heading into the NBA. Then outside of watching him play and just seeing him glide through the defense or knock down threes at a high percentage, his numbers were just ridiculously good. Some people didn't think his three-point shot would translate to the NBA. Well, so far that has been anything but the case, but his low usage rate combined with his ability to hit the deep ball and playmake for others was similar to someone like Lonzo Ball coming out of college, actually pretty much identical in the statistical department. And I think their games aren't exactly the same, but in terms of their profile statistically and as a player, they're pretty close. You can definitely see the similarities. But one thing that I've noticed about Haliburton, different to someone like Lonzo and different to a lot of rookies, is just his confidence on the three ball. It's not necessarily always about how technically good you are or just whether you can make threes or not, because when it comes down to it, how many NBA players can consistently hit 20 threes in a row in the practice facility? Pretty much all of them. That's the answer, particularly at the guard position. Probably except Ben Simmons. Yeah. And Russell Westbrook. Most of those guys can definitely knock down a number of three balls when it's not really an issue mentally. So that's where I've seen Haliburton separate himself from this year's draft and just prospects in general over the last few years. We've already seen him ice the game against the Nuggets with not just a three ball, actually two of them, but not just any three ball. He hit it from like 30 feet out, which was ridiculous, with the game on the line to win them the game effectively, to close it out, just to drop a bomb on a team like Denver. That was something else. And then against the Rockets as well, late in the shot clock to tie the game with only a minute or so remaining, he hit a corner three and just stood there and watched it sail in. You saw the confidence in his stroke. You saw the confidence in his face as the ball left his hands. Some of that just can't be measured with stats or with how well they play or just their mechanics. Sometimes it's purely just about the confidence of someone as a shooter, and he clearly has that early on in his NBA career, which I think is going to hold him in good stead, and it already has. Now, like I was saying about his shooting, it's pretty much been lights out. He shot 10 of 20 from beyond the arc at a ridiculous 50%. Now, it's a little bit awkward, but it's a stable base and a strong follow through, which in my estimation seems to be enough. And from my experience, if you've got a good follow through and a stable base, you're more than likely going to be able to hit those shots, even if it looks a bit goofy, which is kind of what it looks like. But overall, his shooting's just been faultless, and it makes sense when you look at what he was able to do in college. Now, saying he shot 87% from the free throw line as well to start his NBA career. Now, it might be a bit inconvenient and awkward, but Haliburton is getting his shots to drop. And if he can hover around that 40%, given everything he can do offensively outside of just shooting, the Kings have got an absolute steal, and more importantly, a long-term partner for De'Aaron Fox in a potential backcourt that could be very, very dangerous. But outside of his shooting, one thing that's just stood out to me is Haliburton just consistently makes the right plays. I'm not going to pin the last two losses on the absence of him, but his impact defensively and offensively off the bench and in the starting lineup when he gets that run with guys like Fox and Hield, it's just incredible for a rookie, to be honest. A very, very good playmaker already, one of the best shooters in the league currently, and someone who just makes the right plays defensively and offensively. He already seems to be the glue guy of this Kings team. You look at guys like PJ Tucker, Draymond Green, Marcus Smart, all for different reasons. These guys are glue guys on their teams. And I think for Halliburton's offensive play, in terms of him taking the load off De'Aaron Fox and creating plays for others, his ability to get in the passing lanes, make very smart decisions on the defensive end of the the floor. Not to mention, obviously, his cold-blooded shooting. All of these factors just suggest to me he's incredibly important already to this Kings team as a rookie. Getting back to what I was saying about the last two Kings losses, when you look at their assist percentage over the last two games, it was the third worst in the league. Now, I'm not going to pin that all on just Haliburton because a number of things happened. I don't need to go into detail, but you know, it's obviously not going to be one-to-one. But then you look at their assist percentage in the five games while he was playing, and it makes sense given someone like De'Aaron Fox doesn't really have a secondary playmaker on that team outside of, I guess, what, Corey Joseph? There's just not enough playmaking unless you're LeBron, Luka. Sorry, Kings fans, I know that's a tough topic at this point in time, particularly with LaVar Ball Light making all those statements about Marvin Bagley. It brings back some bad memories, but unless you're Luka, LeBron, or Jokic, you can't run the offense without any secondary playmaker, and still those guys have secondary playmakers and elite second options. So basically, De'Aaron Fox needs help, and Haliburton is that help on the offensive side of the floor. That's why the Kings offense has been a lot more stagnant and just looked not the same in the slightest since he's gone out. He's a rookie, but he's already making an impact like he's a vet. Kind of leading on from that to his passing just in general, something that's translated is his assist to turnover ratio. It was fantastic in college, and his playmaking already looks fantastic in the NBA. He just makes the right decisions. He doesn't try to force anything, which can often be the case as a rookie. It helps that he's playing off ball at times and he has a pretty low usage rate. But in general, an assist to turnover ratio of 5.5 is ridiculous for someone who's already recorded over 20 assists. That ratio is good enough to have him in the top 10 and ahead of guys like Chris Paul, Malcolm Brogdon, DeMar DeRozan, pretty much anyone outside of the top 10, like I mentioned. He's ahead of a number of players when it comes to assist to turnover ratio, and it just shows how good his playmaking is already. More importantly, just how good his intelligence is, because I think a lot of rookies can make the passes he can make just on a skill level, but in terms of just making the right decisions all the time, that's where he separates himself from other rookies and just other players in general already in his NBA career. But like I alluded to, it hasn't just been his offensive game, it's also been his defensive game, which has seen him be really smart on the defensive end of the floor. If there's one way to sum it up, it's just making the right plays. That's pretty much a way to sum up his whole game. Yeah, thank you for coming to the video. Haliburton is a smart player offensively and defensively. That's it. That sums him up. Smart offensively, smart defensively, good player alongside De'Aaron Fox. Good pairing. But getting back to his defense, something that I noticed, particularly in that Houston game, was just his ability to deflect the ball, get in the passing lanes, and get out in transition when he did so. It makes sense because he's second in the team for deflections per 36 at just under 3 a game, and he's clearly got the most loose balls recovered as well. Now, normally I wouldn't look too much into these stats, although I think they do hold quite a lot of merit because someone's ability to deflect the ball, get in the passing lanes, recover loose balls, shows their positional awareness and their ability to make the right plays off the ball, not just on the ball, which people often give so much weight defensively. Players do off the ball is probably more important because that's where you spend most of your time defending. So he's clearly a good off-ball defender, and that's backed up by the statistics. We saw it in college, so it's no surprise. Now, I'm not one who always comes with statistics, but when you have those statistics, particularly for a rookie player, a lot of people probably haven't even seen him play very much. So to have these statistics to back it up just means what I'm saying isn't purely anecdotal. As I mentioned at the start of the video, there wasn't a ton of prospects that I paid close attention to in the lead up to the draft, but Haliburton was one, and I'm glad because he looks fantastic through his first five games. At the time of recording this, he is currently out with a wrist injury, which hopefully won't be too bad because for one, I mean, he's got a chance at rookie of the year. I think he's been the best rookie to start the season, and two, he's already one of the Kings' best and most important players, which isn't a shot at the Kings. It should more say about how good he is as a rookie, and more importantly, how important he is to this team because of his playmaking, because of his defense and his ability to kind of mesh everything together for this second unit and this starting unit when guys like De'Aaron Fox and Buddy Hield are sharing the floor with him. If there's just one word that I could use to describe him, it would be good. I know, I'm going out on a limb there and I'm going kind of crazy. Good. Good offensively, good defensively, good intelligence. He's just a good person, a good player, and a fantastic fit alongside De'Aaron Fox, which I think is going to be an absolutely terrorizing duo going forward. The intelligence, the playmaking of Haliburton and the shooting, the swiftness, the playmaking, everything De'Aaron Fox offers as well. Kings fans, I know it's still early, particularly in Tyrese Halliburton's development, but that duo could be something special going forward. And I think if the first few games of his career are anything to go by, I'll just leave it at that. I'm happy to finally see Sacramento have something to cheer about because over the last several years, it's been no secret they haven't had much to cheer about at all. Ends with Marvin Bagley and LaVar Ball Light, bringing back bad memories of that dreaded draft night just a few years ago. You've arguably got yourself the best rookie in the class so far, And to get him at number 12, someone who's not just a fantastic rookie, but a fantastic fit and a fantastic person overall, it looks like a steal before the draft. And now after the draft, it looks like a steal as well. So I'm going to go out on a limb and say it's a steal. I'd probably bet on him being one of the best prospects, one of the best players to come out of this draft, which is something to be incredibly excited for. Anyways, if you made it to the end of the video, a like would be greatly appreciated. Hope you have a good day. Catch you next time. Bye.